in the few minutes to introduce this topic, I will say that I would like to just put this these campaigns, the successes that we had in Seattle, but also in Minneapolis. In Minneapolis, we came within 229 votes of winning another council seat, as well in, but of course, in the case of Kshama Sawant's campaign, it was a citywide campaign. We got over 95,000 votes, and in terms of the, and it was a spectacular result. But the campaign in Minneapolis was nothing to sneeze at, in the sense that it was a great, it was within, as I said, 200 votes of winning the seat. But I want to locate these events, these developments, in a world context for a couple of minutes. One is the continuing economic crisis that's plaguing capitalism since 2008, that is in the deeper background, if you like, of a lot of these developments. We have seen also the explosive movements of the working class in South Africa, in Egypt, in Brazil, and the Turkish uprisings over the course of the past period. And I think that, and of course the fierce resistance of the working class, especially in South Europe. We saw with the general strikes in Greece, in Spain, in Portugal, and so on. I'm only sketching an outline, but because we have to locate these developments of what's taking place here in the US in the context of the world situation. Of course, as I mentioned before, John mentioned the rise of Syriza, which is a new political formation that used to be very small, but it's now beginning to emerge to become the possibility of a first left government in Greece in a very long time. We have, of course, the entry of Latin America into the world revolutionary process, not only with Brazil and Chile, where we saw the movements of Brazil, but with the Trotskyist left, the different strands of the Trotskyist left in Argentina, getting 1.4 million votes in the last elections around the Frente de Izquierda de Trabajadores, the front left, workers left front, in the crisis of Peronism. And of course in Asia we've seen the movements in Thailand and India. These developments, they reflect, I'm sketching this very, very briefly because a lot of these points can be elaborated, but it is indicative that we're entering in many ways, after a prolonged period of economic crisis, a new year of mass struggles and a new phase that we're entering. Even features like we've seen, the crisis that begin to develop, the fracturing of the ruling circles, having debates and divisions about how to deal with the economic crisis of capitalism. We have even the Pope being forced to speak in terms of inequality, against untrammeled capitalism. It's nothing to sneeze at. It reflects the ideological crisis, that the crisis is not simply economic and social, but it's an ideological crisis that's evolving at the present time on a world scale. To locate these campaigns, again, I'm only touching these points, is that you have to put this debate with the earthquake of the Occupy movement that exploded the surface, that shifted, in many ways, the tectonic plates of US politics. Even though the movement was defeated, it revealed, if you like, the soft underbelly, the crisis that underlies the crisis of American capitalism at the present time. We had the Wisconsin uprising, the near general strike in Oakland, the movement that we saw in the West Coast in the ports around Longview, and the emergence in those developments of the potential for militant struggle, while the heroic movement of the teacher strikes and movement in Chicago with the tremendous community support, again it was indicative of the movement. And of course the campaigns for low pay that began small and slowly, but they spread around the country over the course of the last 2 years. So this is the background around which these developments are taking place. I want to locate them in that because that is where it makes sense. You can see there that these developments are not accidental developments that have taken place. These are historic votes for socialists, but even then we were not alone. Actually, in the case of Lorain, Ohio, we saw in Lorain County in Ohio, and I want to mention my friend Dan Lobotz is here, and it's a in Ohio, where socialists again got thousands of votes in the elections a few years ago. I can't remember, I wasn't prepared for that, but I wanted to remind people. But also, in the case of Ohio, we had actually 24 Labour candidates, not open socialists. It reflects, however, a fracturing. That's the key issue of the political compact for that of the Democratic Party. And that was also reflected with the elections of de Blasio and Marty Walsh in Boston. These are populist campaigns. They reflected their rejection on a deeper level, aside from the subjective intentions of what this, these are capitalist politicians that speak left, can speak right, can swing this way and that. But from the point of view of why people vote, well, it was such a shift in the conscience, reflects a deep shift in the mood and in the consciousness that that took place. We also had Chokwe Lumumba in the summertime, was elected in Jackson, Mississippi, speaking specifically, referring to his campaign, elected as a Democrat, but relating himself concretely with the movement, with the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, which was a split, of course, that developed in the Democratic Party in the 1960s in the course of the civil rights movement, and so on. And of course, we had the campaign of Howie Hawkins in Syracuse, with a despicable role. I don't have the time to go on the despicable role played by the Working Families Party, yeah, in terms of actively campaigning to defeat one of the best left-wing voices that we have, one of the best worker activists who has actually opened the door for the possibilities, hopefully we'll discuss, of electoral campaigns that he opened with his gubernatorial election, which actually allows access to the ballot, which would be virtually impossible for other people to do, or would be extremely difficult to do. All of these are features of well, there is a generalization that could be drawn from these points. And that is, why is this happening? The reason why this is happening is this, is that the industrial avenue, in terms of fighting back, is blocked. And that is blocked partly because of the collapse of industrial relations, the extremely, extremely conservative role of the union leaderships that does not allow, actually, for this movement to be reflected through a movement, through a work, traditionally, through a strike wave, for example. It does not take that. And also, to some degree, the defeat of the street protests that open up with Occupy, also, that is not seen as an avenue as easily, because it was very heavy-handedness of the police apparatus, you know, that played the certain role. That has created the space, if you like, for an opening for people to register their radicalization, the discontent with what is taking place through the political arena. And that is partly what is, I think, it's beginning. There's a lot to be said. Now, in the course of the discussion, we'll discuss more about the campaigns. But I think it would be a mistake not to try to put this in context, if you like, these developments of what has taken place. The three lessons that can be said about, and I will stop on this. I will stop on this point, and then we will return, hopefully, in the course of the discussion, to discuss more in detail about the concrete movements that take place. Is that in this period, the socialist left has to show audacity, has to show a clear confidence in our ideas, in the sense that the working class, where we put a clear program forward, that the masses will move behind. The political space has opened up on the left. We need, however, these campaigns to be grounded. They need to be linked to the local, to actual struggles, and you need an organization in place as well. You need a correct analysis, some perspectives regarding the program. We'll discuss some of the issues. I'm sure there's going to be discussion about the program and what way that this is going to be. This makes these things possible in the present period. And I think because we have entered precisely this period of time that the socialist left, not only in the U.S. but internationally, events are international. The rise of the potential rise of a mass party of the left, of the socialist left, whether it's in South Africa, whether it's in Brazil, or whether it's in Greece, it will have an impact inevitably in the consciousness. It will begin to transform the consciousness of the proletariat and of the working class on an international scale. So I'll finish with that point, one of my favorite quotes from Karl Marx, which is that if philosophers have interpreted the world, there's a hell of a lot of commentary being written all over the internet about everything and anything, but the point is to change it. And if there's something to be said about Kshama Sawant's campaign, is that Kshama Sawant's campaign and Socialist Alternative's campaign in Seattle and Ty Moore's in Minneapolis have begun to transform, if you like, become a factor for the first time in a very long time, a factor in terms of the actual developments of the class struggle in two of the major cities around the country. And I hope that this is going to be the opening that we will be able to build upon and build a powerful socialist movement in the next period in the US. Thank you.
Thanks, Alan. Jen Roesch from ISO.
Hi, welcome everybody. The first thing I just wanted to say was congratulations to Socialist Alternative and to Kshama Sawant in particular. I agree that her election has transformed the U.S. political landscape in a way that I think is tremendously exciting, and I think is one of the things that most has served to highlight the radicalization that's been taking place in this country since Occupy, really. I agree that it really reflects the same expression that took place coming out of Occupy. And I really agree a lot with what Alan said about the international context in which this is taking place. I wanted to actually respond to some of what he said and then lay out what I think some potential next steps, challenges, questions that we have to grapple with are. The first thing I wanted to do is just lay out quickly what the ISO's general approach is to elections for people who may not know, because the general approach we've always taken is neither to say that we abstain from elections altogether, there's no point in participating in capitalist elections, et cetera, but nor that you need to run candidates in every single election cycle. Instead, we've tried to lay out a set of criteria for understanding, one, what are the forces on our side, on the left, how can what I think are the still relatively small resources of the left be used most effectively to advance the sort of consciousness, confidence and combativity of working class people and of the left in order to take a step forward? And then what kind of space exists for an independent electoral alternative to the left of the Democratic Party? I think that that aspect of it is very important as well, because there's a specific feature of the United States where, unlike in Europe, we have a political system that is held in a stranglehold by two parties that both represent the capitalist class. And I think for if the left to begin to move forward, for the working class to begin to move forward, the question of how do we begin to build an independent political alternative to the Democratic Party is one that I think has dogged us for a very long time. And so what that means is that I think election campaigns can take very different forms in different contexts. So for example, in 2000, Ralph Nader's campaign, while Ralph Nader was not a revolutionary, socialist, committed member of a political organization like Kshama Sawant by any stretch of the imagination, was also able to articulate and be a vehicle for the discontent coming out of the global justice movement, 8 years of Clintonism, and really was again a sort of Seattle, interestingly enough, I don't know what it is about Seattle, but Seattle goes to the polls. I think now one of the things that is very inspiring is that Sawant ran an openly socialist campaign, and I think for anybody who still has any kind of hangover that socialism is a dirty word, I think it's time for us to get over it. I think it's time for us to be proud of being a socialist. Alternative in this country, and part of the task for us and for this generation is to rebuild that sense of what exists. And I think that, I would just say that I think there are real opportunities that exist to the left of the Democratic Party and for electoral alternatives in this country. And I think the Time Moore campaign, the Sawant campaign, the Ohio campaign, I mean, you just literally gave all the examples I was going to give. I'll just add one, which is the Chicago Teachers Union, which led the strike last year, just voted a resolution to form an independent labor organization that's exploring the possibility of running independent candidates, independent of the Democratic Party in Chicago. If that were to take place, wow, that would be an even more significant break, because what that represents is the Democratic Party's traditional brace. It directly goes against Rahm Emanuel, against Obama, and I think it represents then a deepening and an acceleration of the struggle that's been taking place inside the Chicago Teachers Union for several years. And I think one of the things that we need to grasp deep in our bones is that this is not some kind of like splashy campaign, but really reflects a deepening class discontent that exists in this country as a result of the impact of the economic crisis that's taken place here. And I think just to give people a sense, the growing immiseration of the working class in this country and the growing inequality is reaching astronomical proportions. So for example, average wages for auto workers in the South are 30% lower than they are in Michigan. You just think about what that means for an entire generation of people's living standards. You have wages are so low here that IKEA, Hyundai, Kia, Honda, Toyota, Volkswagen are all opening plants in the South in this country because suddenly the U.S. has become the low-wage labor force. And so it's not a question of like offshoring. It's actually that companies are coming back because of low wages, which is, I think, why the fight for 15 and the $15 an hour minimum wage that Sawant talked about is so important in terms of being a focal point for that discontent. I was stunned, I don't know if people have seen, but they did a map of the votes for Sawant in Seattle, and you look at the map, and literally, like, the ring around the outside of Seattle that's on the waterfront where all the middle and upper class people live went overwhelmingly for Conlon, the Democrat. And then if you look at the inner neighborhoods where people are making less than $40,000 a year, that's where it went for Sawant. This was not just some kind of literary middle class intellectual rejection of the Democratic Party. This was a working class rejection of the Democratic Party. I think to fuse those two things will be really important. I had a question when Alan, I'm literally just responding off the cuff, but I had a question when Alan said that the electoral sort of space that exists and the electoral campaigns represent the expression of the anger where other avenues have been blocked. I'm not sure I would conceptualize it in that way. I think it's true that there has been a blockage of an avenue for people to express their discontent in terms of, you know, low level of strike statistics and the defeat of Occupy and all the rest of that. But I think it would be more helpful to understand the electoral challenges really as one aspect of an overall process that faces challenges on many different fronts. And so I think that the success of Sawant's campaign, the basis for that was laid precisely by Occupy. I think the success of the $15 an hour minimum wage call was laid by the fast food workers who struck in New York and Chicago and are building rank and file committees in Chicago that, you know, have projected that issue into the national spotlight. I think there's a whole number of social struggles that have flown under the radar screen that have been incredibly important, whether that's the struggle of family members against police brutality, is that has come into the forefront again, whether that's the immigrant rights movement of 2006, the mass immigrant rights movement, which I think has continued to have reverberations and an impact. And so I think in some ways, even when you look at the defeats for our side or the defeats for the left, they can be as important in telling us what things look like as some of the tremendous successes are. So for example, the day after Sawant won the election in Seattle, she went to speak to a rally of Boeing workers, which was just the most incredible thing to see an openly socialist council member or, you know, future council member going and speaking to Boeing workers as they were literally being blackmailed and threatened that the plant was going to shut down, all the jobs were going to move out of Seattle if they didn't vote for a contract that gutted, you know, basically gutted any union protections and introduced a two-tier wage system. I don't know if people will have seen, but the union leadership ended up being able to force through that contract. They had to take two votes. They had to hold it at a time when they knew people weren't even going to be there. They had to do a whole shutdown. They finally were able to drive it through 51% to 49%. But if you only looked at the defeat of that campaign, you would miss something, because what also happened in that process is a layer of activists began to knit together. There was one woman who organized a whole Facebook page and website to oppose the contract. People began to form an opposition caucus and began to talk about what would it take to build rank and file power inside of that Boeing factory to begin to push for something. That is another aspect. That's another expression of the struggle that I think was represented in Sawant's campaign. Okay, and so I think that if we think about a strategy, we have to think about how do we build on all of those fronts at once. And the problem for us, obviously, is that we remain a small left. So I'll just end by talking very quickly about what I think some of the next steps are for us. I think that we should begin to talk and discuss and explore the ideas of how we can build an electoral challenge that's broader than just in one or two or three cities and draws in more people. If we're going to do that, I think there's a couple of preconditions. One is that we have to find ways for the existing left and progressive forces to work together in a principled way, much more frequently, collaboratively, in an ongoing way, which does not mean collapsing all differences that exist between us or not having debates, but it does mean that we have to overcome the sort of silo effect of different socialists and progressives doing their own things in their own space and begin to find spaces like this to come together and to debate. I think the second thing we need to do is reach well beyond the forces of the organized left, because I think you know, one of the questions I think Ben Campbell, who organized this event, wrote was, can electoral vehicles serve as a way of overcoming the fragmentation of the post-Occupy left? And I think there's some truth to that. I also, one way I would think about it is, when you think about Occupy, it wasn't just the left that existed in Zuccotti Park, but it's the tens of thousands of people who went to Zuccotti Park and participated in protests and marches who gave it that mass character. That audience still exists there. How do we begin to bring those people into organized, active, practical activity? Not just, you know, how do we get them to vote at the ballot box, but how do we make them part of that 400 volunteers that Sawant's campaign had in Seattle? And so I think that's a real challenge for us. I'll just end by saying locally here in New York, people have talked about, or Alan talked about, Bill de Blasio's election. I think that poses a huge challenge for the left in the city, because I simultaneously agree that it reflects the seismic shift that we see taking place everywhere else. At the same time, de Blasio is completely committed, in my opinion, to pursuing, you know, to not going against Wall Street, not going into a confrontation with Wall Street. And I think, you know, his appointment of Braddon, I think the fact that he signaled that he doesn't want to sign fair contracts for, you know, the teachers, the nurses, the city workers, et cetera, means that we're in a position where I think de Blasio will attempt to pull in whole sections of the left into some kind of dialogue, discussion, et cetera. How do we begin to build an independent campaign and use the next few years? There's not elections locally in New York City for 4 years. How do we begin to build that kind of left alliance that I was talking about, and rooted inside of unions, rooted inside of social movements, of people who say, how do we begin to pose an alternative to this? I know that there are city union workers putting forward a petition demanding full retro pay for the people who've been going years without their contract. I think there's a discussion about what it's going to look like for the teachers who've been going out without pay and who have been, you know, very, I think, inspiring in a lot of the struggles, I'm going to end in one sec, that have been happening locally. And so I think that's the immediate question for us, which can't be disconnected from, is there space for an electoral alternative, but has to be seen as part of that process. I know that Hallie Hawkins has declared his intention to run for the Green Party nomination for governor in New York. I think that would be a huge thing for us to keep our eyes on and look to, particularly given the issues of New York City and Albany and the relationship there in terms of what can be pushed through. We can't have a $15 hour minimum wage ordinance in New York City. And so that raises the question, because it's not allowed under our constitution, everything. So that raises the question of how we build a statewide campaign. So those are some of the things I think we can begin to look at, but I think we have to figure out how to bring that electoral challenge back to the very concrete next steps for rebuilding a militant alternative and an independent alternative here in New York City in the coming years, that can then be in a position to talk about a broader and more cohesive campaign that unites different leftist progressives and the audience that look to Occupy. But I'm very hopeful about the prospects that exist.
I turned my ankle, so I'm going to sit, but I agree that standing is the correct revolutionary practice. That's the case with any disputes. It's not a symbolic thing. But I'll also keep my remarks short, since I don't want to rehash what was already said, much of which I agree with. Also, the Knicks were playing Indiana today, so the game started early, started at 7, so hopefully we can all get out of here by 9 something. But I do want to reiterate that the achievements of the social alternative campaigns in Minneapolis and in Seattle should obviously be applauded. I think some concrete lessons can be drawn from them. The first of which is that socialists, as comfortable as we are with our status as underdogs, we seem to like cherish and relish it a bit too much, can actually win, but only if we outwork our opponents. That means patiently building organizational capabilities, raising adequate funds, and also winning over key segments of the Democratic coalition. Sawant and Moore had the backing of local housing and immigrant rights movements, as well as labor. Sawant drew official endorsements from 4 different union locals. Moore had the support of SAIU's Minnesota State Council, which is particularly influential. Both candidates out-fundraised their opponents, I think, by 3-1. 3-1? Yeah. You know, they also had a deeper ground game. They had activists willing to put in long hours. Moore said in an interview with Jacobin that they were able to canvass within his district voters many times over, just because it was a relatively small amount of registered voters in the election, and them having so many activists and volunteers. And more importantly, they had the organizational structure to take all this energy and enthusiasm and actually turn them into people that were communicating, pushing forward the platform and winning over support. I think that achievement can't be understated. Beyond that, the Seattle campaign had the support of publications like The Stranger. It had a media buzz, was utilized very well by a very intelligent communications program. And I think it really should be a model that should be closely examined and studied by anyone on the left looking to do something similar. But the base that Social Alternative had in a place like Minneapolis was already in place by the time they went to go do their election. It was a result of almost a decade of work in the anti-war movement, and later work more recently in the anti-foreclosure movement. There was only 12,500 registered voters in that Ward 9, and they were able to raise over $55,000 to canvass and reach out to those 12,500 registered voters. And they did it all as explicit socialists. So I think we have to realize the scale of what they were doing, and if we were trying to replicate something in New York, we would have to think realistically about funding, organization, and how we'd be able to make this happen, beyond just merely applauding their effort. And obviously, due to our 2012 campaign, Sawant came in as a known quantity to Seattle voters. And more importantly, both campaigns were intelligent enough to use broad social democratic demands like the fight for the living wage, around which there was already existing support within these working class communities. But most importantly, I think it's important to note that this wasn't actions done through a front group or through another organization. These are actions done as explicit and open socialists, meaning those demands took on a completely different nature than they would if a similar demands were taken up by liberal left politicians in a city like New York. What's more, I think it's very intelligent that these campaigns have made explicit that this was just the beginning and not the end of something. They haven't demobilized, because this isn't regular electoral politics about electing individual capitalist politicians. This is about building long-term organizations with roots in the community. But when we're talking about New York, I think we need to think soberly about conditions in the city, our strength, and whether it be worth it for organizations like, let's say, the ISO, to which already have a fairly large active base of cadre in the city, to orient their limited resources towards an electoral effort. At the city council level, for instance, like what good would electing one politician be compared to the broad movement work that we're already engaged with? Work that, as I mentioned before, Social Alternative have been doing in cities like Minneapolis for years and years and years before launching their most recent campaign. On that front, we can get into this later in the Q&A, hopefully, but I actually think that the work that continues to go on through Occupy Homes in Minneapolis, that went hand in hand with the electoral campaign, shows that these aren't necessarily mutually exclusive. They can actually feed into each other, but only if going into it we're aware that this should be a goal, to make sure that this electoral work doesn't diminish but rather amplifies movement work. But more importantly, I think the goal should be clear about what we're trying to do by running campaigns or potentially running campaigns. We're not looking to legislate, at least immediately, progressive change. We're looking to build a visible and confident socialist opposition. The landscape of the city, in terms of the mayor, which is already mentioned tonight, and the city council, has indeed moved in more liberal directions. We can hope, and I do hope, that at least there will be some minor gains for people within the system, or at the very least by the standards of the extremely low bar set by the last two administrations. But that doesn't mean that these people, particularly de Blasio, shouldn't be opposed. And I use the word opposed instead of the more euphemistic, holding his feet to the fire, because I actually think in the case of de Blasio, our most efficient, our real political task is to be in opposition, especially as the liberal left returns to being the dominant hegemonic voice in New York City politics, which it was for a large swath of the 60s and 70s. It was a brief intermission with Giuliani and Bloomberg, but now they're back to the dominant voice, the dominant power, and I think it's very important if we're building an opposition movement to separate ourselves and to acknowledge ourselves as being a part of a different movement. But, you know, our goal essentially is to educate, mobilize, and to build a confident minority. But, in other words, we're not trying to build a majority to legislate, but we're trying to build a minority that can change the conditions in which that majority legislates in the short term. Obviously, we have much higher, loftier ambitions. We could talk about 3D blueprinting and the great socialist future soon. But in the short term, I think that should be our goal. But in the future, when socialists push legislation, when we are in that position, the difference will be that even when we're working within the frameworks of the capitalist system, we won't be making technocratic tweaks or backroom deals. We'll be mobilizing people in the street to fight for what we want them to fight for and what we hope that they support, what there's like consensus for, but also hopefully having that energy push things either further left in more radical dimensions that we can even hope or can see for now. And things obviously are easier than it should be. I'll concede that there is room on the left, partially because democratic machines that used to operate as very tight, cohesive groups in cities like Philadelphia and New York and Boston are decaying. Their grip on unions and other groups are loosening, partially because they have no real patronage or anything to dole out. I think enough groups that have been affiliated with the Democratic Party know that they're getting less and less back, and they're having more and more demanded upon them. But I would say, and I think this might be slightly more controversial in a room like this, that people like Tish James, or the core of even what a group like the Working Families Party stands for, shouldn't be immediately opposed to an effort like this. At the city council level, let's say, a socialist opposition need not immediately butt heads with a group like the Working Families Party. I think there's a layer of activists from this quarter that we need to be engaged and not alienated. In other words, the right races need to be picked, and this will have to come organically through community work and tapping into real discontent. I'll give you an example. Tish James's successor was also endorsed by the Working Families Party. It was a much more tepid endorsement. And District 35 seems like a worthwhile place where a lot of us have already been doing movement work, where there's a great degree of discontent on the ground, and where there's a relatively conservative Democrat that could be opposed. I think that's far different than immediately opposing any candidate that has a D next to their name, because in a city like New York, a one-party city, not seeing the gradients between someone like Tish James and someone like these conservative Democrats out in Staten Island is incredibly unsophisticated. I think we have to do better, and we have to be strategic in what races we target and how we try to mobilize people. That doesn't change the fact that I think fundamentally there's room for independent political action in a city like New York. The climate is right. I think most of all, judging by what was said by the representatives of Social Alternative and the ISO, that any groups, socialists who are already affiliated with groups that would be entering into an effort like this would know that the goal of this isn't to build our own organizations, but rather to build a wider, more coherent political opposition. It's to build a political center that could be the nucleus of a deeper, truly mass movement in the future. And I think that's something, if we're all committed to, I think we'll be able to make progress on in the future.
Yeah, well, I have questions. So the plan now is to have kind of moderated discussion. I'm going to kick it off by asking a question, but I think I'll start, I can't resist making one reaction to what Bhaskar said, which is based on a remark that Ken Silverstein, the journalist, made after Obama's nomination. He actually preferred Hillary Clinton in 2008, and the reason was with Hillary Clinton, you could move directly into opposition without an intervening stage of disillusionment. Right? And I think that's actually a really crucial observation for all of us, which is that a lot of leftists engage in this position, which they call so-called critical support. And that applied particularly with Obama, I think was really deadening for the left. You know, that you can spend a certain amount of time allowing the Democrats to screw everything up, or whatever Democrat happens to be elected. You allow them a certain number of years liberty where you hold off on your criticism, and more crucially, you hold off on your organizing in independently. And that's systematically deadening to the left, is to respond to the election of a Democrat by completely dissolving your organization that you established to usually oppose the most reactionary Republican that was in there previously. So I'm really pleased with both the ISO, but particularly Socialist Alternatives, the commitment to develop an independent organization that will be continuous, right? That won't just collapse when a liberal Democrat happens to be elected in some seat. So with that in mind, I'd just like to ask some nuts and bolts question to Alan. What do they have in mind? What's going to happen next? Where are they going to organize? Who are the candidates that they're going to support? And I presume who we should attempt to support on a national level.
All right. I will... I really appreciated the comments. I think that it's a valid and important points have been raised, and we need to discuss them. And these are issues that will come back again and again in the next few. The first thing to say is that I want to read a couple quotes regarding how we approach elections, our general approach to elections, because it's not. I mean, what I meant in my introductory remarks regarding the political space opening up, it's not the exclusion of preference, but objectively speaking, that there is more of a trend in that direction, because it's extremely difficult, as we saw even with the Boeing strike, for workers to take direct industrial action, precisely because their leaderships are not behind them, are not campaigning for these for this. They're taking a very conservative view, and therefore we have a collapse of the level of strike action and so on. That doesn't preclude industrial actions, but nevertheless, it is a trend. The points that I want to address is first of all, regarding these campaigns. In the case of Minneapolis, we had actually the SEIU, the Minneapolis State Council, with 30,000 members, four locals, endorsed Taiwan, an open socialist. And of course, the SEIU, and this is something I want to say about Socialist Alternative, is that we are, it's not as if these people don't know that we're opposed to SEIU's policy of supporting Democrats. we have told them over and over. So the reason why the SEIU Council was forced to do that is because of the work that we've built. In the three strikes that SEIU locals were engaged in, the Socialist Alternative was at the forefront of building solidarity for those workers, and it was impossible for the leadership to go to their own ranks and say, well, you can't support this guy, because everyone in SEIU, the activists of SEIU, the people who were involved in strikes and everything else, knew that these were the people that were there with us in every strike. They knew. The same applies with regard to the point about home foreclosures, is that for us, actually, we continued and deepened the struggle that opened with the Occupy movement. Socialist Alternative, along with Occupy Homes, played a critical role in terms of activists and so on in building this movement to defeat the repossessions of houses of ordinary people in Minneapolis. It was very difficult, and it forced even the quite conservative union officials to actually go behind the campaign. But I want to read the quote. I actually meant to give the quote first, about how we approach this kind of politics. This is a quote from Ty, the article that you wrote for the Jacobin. We set out, Ty Moore says, we set out a new model of completely different type of politics, one rooted in the idea that movements are primarily for the working class and that elections should only be viewed as a tactic to build workers' class consciousness, independent organization, and self-confidence. In other words, to build the self-confidence of the working class to be able to conduct serious fights. This is a model with deep roots in the history of Marxism in the U.S. and internationally, but forgotten by many activists today. And I think that that is a very valid. It reveals quite clearly the approach that we take with regard to how we see politics. It was not in the case of Minneapolis. It was not coincidental. We ran actually against quite a progressive Democrat, Alondra Cano. Was a progressive Latina See, and it represents this kind of block, this kind of progressive democrat politics, you know, or building an ethnic bloc in many ways, of identity politics, that we're running as a Latina and as a woman and everything else. And we're able to overcome that in many ways, actually, in the course of the campaign, because Tai is not Latino and is not a woman, you know, as a socialist, you know. And we were, but it was interesting that we got tremendous support in the Latino community. We got the Centro de Trabajadores en Lucha, which is a major worker center in Minneapolis, to go behind. We had 20 very prominent Latino activists and so on going behind the campaign, because precisely we made the appeal on a class basis, in terms of saying that we're not asking for people to vote each other because of their identity, but primarily because of their class affiliation and so on. Now, in the case of Seattle, I will say this in terms of what is that the key issue that comes out for us in Seattle is the campaign for the minimum, for the $15 minimum wage now. And actually what propelled this campaign to victory was precisely the involvement of Socialist Alternative in the movement for the campaign for 15, both in SeaTac, which was a major struggle, but also in terms of catching fire among large sections of the working class, as Jennifer said, and so on. And I think that that is something that was the key in terms of propelling this campaign to victory. This was again because of the kind of roots that we had in real movements, and also we are linking this directly. Anybody who goes to 15now.org, that you will see that actually we are launching. This is a launching pad for this campaign to become a real campaign. And of course, there's many ways that the issue of 15 can be approached. For example, the new mayor spoke, and actually because of our campaign, forced even section of the Democrats to speak about 15. But what they mean is that we're going to put it in a committee, and over 100,000 years we're going to reach, you know, 15. That's what they mainly do. That's exactly what de Blasio and others, you know, intend to do. They speak radical in the course of the elections, but of course, and this, well, it's not viable, it's not feasible. He will do it in, you know, 100 years, we'll see. You know, that kind of an idea. But the point about this is that we're not going to let this issue die. We're going to build a real movement on the ground. If John gives me 1 minute, I want to actually open the discussion a little bit, because the issue of work and families came up, and I think it's absolutely critical, because it touches virtually everything that we do in many ways. The issue of the Working Families Party, I mean, I referred explicitly to the despicable role that they played in the case of because they were actually at the tip of the spear of reaction against the election of Howie Hawkins.
Yeah.
And they actually actively campaigned, they were at the forefront, and trying to give a progressive veneer to defeat a genuine independent campaign by giving it a progressive veneer. So, well, that would be a setback and so on and so forth. The Working Families Party, by the way, in terms of history, the Working Families Party was launched at the time when Labour Militant at the time, the predecessor of Socialist Alternative, we were at the very center of building the Labour Party, of being involved in the campaign to build, at that time, the campaign for Labour, around Tony Mazzacchi, and so on and so on. A section of the union bureaucracy around the CWA, and so on, launched this as a symmetrical doppelganger to try to counter the effect of an independent movement from below. At that time, it was around the unions. They launched the Working Families Party as a way to say it's a safe strategy, inside-outside strategy towards the Democrats. But I want to say why it's touching us all so deeply. You can see that actually in the case of CORE in Chicago, the discussion that's taking place, the model that actually is being in many ways being proposed is precisely that. If you look at what the main resolution is coming forward in terms of the independent political organization for CORE, which is a bit of a concession to the mood that exists among people for independent politics, for an independent campaigns, but nevertheless, the conservative elements inside CORE and inside the CTU are actually pushing for an inside-outside. They already actually endorsed progressive Democrats with a view of saying, well, it's easier, it's more feasible, and everything else. But from our point of view, as we said, it is actually the point of running electoral campaigns is not simply because we want to have friends in office and so on. It's not simply that. It's an issue of mobilizing the independent power of the work, the self-confidence, and use them as levers to build an independent workers' movement. And behind that, I'll finish on this, is the critical task of the American left, which is the building of a mass workers' party over the next period in the years. Because that, these campaigns can become the opening shots, if you like, in which a broader movement around a building of a mass workers' party could begin to develop at a later stage, which will pose a whole lot of different questions. So I'll stop there because I've already spoken too long.
No,
but I think it's important to start this discussion about the Working Families Party and the pressure type of
politics. Well, it's also important for us to be aware of where we are in terms of these victories for municipal office. You know how many municipal office holders there are in the United States? Yeah. Well, this is what the Greens, we had about 220 by some rough count at one point. That was kind of our high watermark. And the Dems always poo-pooed that thing because they said, that's out of 5,000 offices. Okay? So now, the reason why I asked Alan the question was, what's the next step? Is because if this is really going to take fire, right, we can't be talking about counting the number of candidates on the fingers of one hand. We really have to have a strategy for growing exponentially, right? And that's what I'm looking for from, say, some of the speakers. What's our strategy for not just gradual growth, I mean exponential growth, right? That's what's going to happen, right? 5,000 municipal offices, keeping that in mind. Oh, just one quick response, which maybe some of the other speakers would like to pick up on. Historically, it's rather an interesting matter that socialist parties, interesting book, I think, by Eric Chester, some might know, on the history of socialists, independent socialists, parties. He makes the observation, which was new to me, that the notion of a labor party intervening on a stage from the bourgeois mainstream parties to a socialist party was explicitly repudiated by socialists, including Eugene Debs, for rather obvious reasons when you think about it, which is the labor unions have been either unenthusiastic or deeply hostile, at least on an organizational level, to supporting third-party challenges. And the question which we're going to have to answer for ourselves as independent socialists is whether we actually try to court them to gain their support, or we operate independently of them on a rank and file level. So that's something maybe some of the speakers would like to pick up on. So Jen, you're welcome to respond to what's been said so far.
Oh gosh, there's so much. Just on that last question of appealing, I mean, I think one of the things, if you think about the labor movement, one of the things that pushed the labor movement the most to be open to the left and open to new ideas was Occupy. It wasn't a series of negotiations or discussions. It was the eruption of Occupy onto the stage that then forced the unions to say, maybe this is somehow a source of fresh inspiration or whatever. And so I think that the building up of an independent political alternative has to be our starting point. A couple of things. One, you just mentioned 5,000 municipal offices and all the rest of that, which sounds incredibly daunting. I think one of the ways we have to think about it is not simply like, how do we go 10 offices, then 20, then 500, then 1,000. If the question is one of building up an independent political alternative, then it's less about are we able to contend for 5,000 offices and what's our sort of progress in terms of electing socialist or independent candidates, but actually looking at the political impact of some of these campaigns. So the Sawant campaign, the Timor campaign, those are only two campaigns, but dramatically, I think, changed the political landscape in terms of what people's expectations are of what's possible. I guess I want to say a couple things. One, I very much agree with Alan on the impact of the Working Families Party, and I think that that's something that we have to deal with here in New York City. They have constantly acted as a demobilizing factor in terms of any kind of alternative to the left that could exist. I think in terms of how that strategy is being argued or being played out within the Chicago Teachers Union, to me, I think that's an open question. I think the difference between the way in which the CWA set up the Working Families Party as an alternative to the Labor Party is different from the process that's unfolding in the CTU, is that that was a top-down move by the CWA. Within CTU, what you have is an energized and mobilized rank-and-file base that's in a process of formation that's going through a political process of trying to figure out where you go. So they had the strike, which was you know, an enormous step forward and success, and yet then right at the same time, Rahm Emanuel turns around and closes down all these schools in Chicago, which then raises the question of political power within the minds of all sorts of workers and their supporters within Chicago. There's going to be then a debate about that, both in terms of do we actually go for genuine independent political action, and I think that's a debate that's unfolding, and even if we do go for independent political action, do we see just winning office in Chicago as the way around this roadblock that Rahm Emanuel threw up? Or is it that we need to combine a political sort of alternative in response to Rahm Emanuel with continuing to build that rank and file base, to continue to build the sort of workplace power? Because if the union itself were stronger, it's not that there's something inevitable that they can't win against Rahm Emanuel without taking control of City Hall. It's actually about the level of, you know, organization and capacity that exists within the schools. And so I think that's a debate that's unfolding. And I'll just end quickly by saying, two things. One, on the question of industrial action being blocked, I think that's a mixed bag. I think the fast food strikes are incredibly inspiring and represent a similar expression. The Portland teachers are deadlocked with their school board and are poised to go on strike. People, everyone should keep an eye out for that, by the way. They may be forced out on strike as early as tomorrow. We'll need to talk about building a solidarity campaign here. But I'll just end by saying I think Bhaskar makes a really important point about the roots and organization that made the Socialist Alternative campaigns possible and the fact that they were straight up Socialist Alternative campaigns. This is one organization, like, you know, building alliances and building on their movement strength to put forward a campaign. They did a spectacular job. How you both replicate that and expand that and bring in new forces and other organizations and other people, that requires an ongoing discussion. I think that's both possible. I think that's the challenge for us. I think that's what the left has to rise to. I actually think in some ways that began with Dan Labate's campaign. I remember out of that we formed the Socialist Contingent on the demonstration in Washington, D.C. That then gave rise to some of the efforts around the Eco-Socialist Network. I know personally there's been a lot more collaboration that we've had to have on the left in order to take advantage of these opportunities. I think we need to get really concrete about what that will take in order to move that forward in a place like New York and nationally, because I think the possibility is there, but it's not just a springboard straight from these election successes to the next step, but a series of discussions and I think preliminary steps and working together that has to begin to happen to make that possible.
Great. My piece in Counterpunch on the Working Families Party was called WFPWTF on the Hawkins campaign. Well, Bhaskar, you had some positive things to say about the WFP, which I should say well taken points. Okay, I mean I think we should get a nuanced appreciation of them and also a nuanced critique of them. I think we've gotten a nuanced critique. To some degree, maybe in somewhat a nuanced appreciation.
That headline is almost New York Post worthy. Well, my point wasn't really about appreciation or not. My point wasn't any sort of moral or deeper stance to them. It was a purely tactical point. So it's not a matter of supporting or not supporting the WFP. I'm just saying, if we're going to investigate or think about independent political action as socialists, we have to think about how we relate to the Working Families Party, which means not only their leadership, but the activists and the people they mobilize. Which means, I think, so I suggested, I named a name and I mentioned a district, and I said, here's a possible example of a relatively conservative Democrat, at least more conservative than the mood in her district and her predecessor, someone tepidly endorsed by the Working Families Party, which means, you know, just a nominal endorsement but not really resources spent on the race or anything like that. So an example like that, you're making them the aggressors. You're making them oppose you, just like they did in Syracuse. And one of the reasons why that Syracuse story got out was because of that piece we ran in Jacobin and among other pieces that were we were mentioning this this action, which I think roundly and should be condemned by the Working Families Party. But in that case, you're forcing a fissure, and there was a fissure within the Working Families Party in their membership over that action, for
there
example.
There was
lots of discontent. So it's not a matter of like who's going to blog or talk openly about something. It's just a general mood, and you don't know that mood unless you're actually engaging with these people. But if you're engaging in left liberal politics in New York, then you should be engaging with these people. Because if you're not going to engage with someone who's a self-described social democrat when you're living in Obama's America in 2014, then I don't know who you're going to engage with. You're going to talk to rooms no bigger than this. So I think fundamentally that if we run the right kind of campaign, that the Working Families Party leadership and the union bureaucracy in a place like New York might rebel against you. But in that case, then you turn that into just the same way this Sawant campaign in Seattle had such a good communications campaign. Then you turn that into something that splits them and splits the movement, and that you turn that to your advantage. I don't think it's a matter of, in other words, even if we had a mass socialist party in this country, from one, you know, C to the other, we have two C's, right? I don't think that you necessarily oppose someone like John Conyers unless the mood on the ground in his district is such that there's this organic uprising, there's this call for some sort of alternative to him. At some point, you obviously do, if we're socialists and we believe in, you know, truly transformational politics, but it's not on the agenda in the short term. So I think there's something very moralistic about saying, if only we're to, like, free ourselves of the blight of the Democrats, then we can move forward. I think we just need to think about this tactically and soberly. In a city like New York, there is room immediately, today, for independent political action. The question is where, what we're going to do, and how we're going to do it. So I think that's one of the reasons why I mentioned how much the Moore campaign, you know, raised. It wasn't just to you know, show how impressive it was they raised $55,000 for 12,000 voters. Now think about a district in New York and think about how much money you would have to raise and how many activists you would have to mobilize, and think about the existing conditions that we have, which, in which case the Working Families Party and their existing bloc does become a roadblock if they're going to actively oppose you. It just makes it all that much different. So, you know, like I said, I think that it's a matter of strategically picking races. I think it's a matter of not necessarily opposing or supporting the Working Families Party, but making them pick the fight and then spinning it to our advantage when they do. And yeah, I completely agree with the statement that elections are primarily at this point propagandistic. That was the point that I was trying to make when I was saying that our goal isn't to immediately legislate. I also think that's why it was important that the social alternative races were for legislative posts and not for executive posts. Because at that point, especially given the broader economic climate, a socialist in office, if that socialist is actually trying to govern, is going to effectively administer austerity in one way or the other. And that's one of the, obviously, dilemmas that Syriza would possibly face as well. And I think we need to think clearly about what building a radical opposition would look like beyond, you know, any sort of moralizing.
Well, if we're going to get out of here for the Knicks, see the rest of the Knicks game, we better start with questions from you guys, okay? And first hand that goes up. Here we go.
All right. My name's Sandy Boyer. I write sometimes for Socialist Worker Online, and I do Radio Free Aaron and WBAI. But I just want to speak a little bit to this, the labor independent political actions, which I think is incredibly important without kind of opposing it to anything else. If the labor movement in this country would break through the Democratic Party, you transform the whole scene. Is that going to happen tomorrow? No. And when it does happen today, it should be partial. Lorain County, they broke, but they're still trying to make it up to the Democrats.
Sure.
Yeah, that's the way it's going to happen in the real world. The Chicago Teachers Union, yeah, they're halfway between, they don't know, but it opens the situation up. We can do things with those openings. And I don't want to be a sectarian, I don't want to counterpose it. They do that, don't do this. No, but just keep your eye on that. Very quickly, the Working Families Party, my approach, and de Blasio, is, look, you dare them to take the struggles on, they won't take on. Like, de Blasio won't break with Cuomo, even right now. Yeah. He can get the little things he wants break with Cuomo. He won't, in terms of housing, I've got an article on Socialist Worker, right? You can't get public housing, which we need in New York, without a huge movement on the streets around the country. De Blasio won't lead that. And the Working Families Party won't lead that. So they can't even do what it would take to organized for their own program. Thank you very much.
Oh, okay. Yep. Oh, great. No questions for the panelists? That's fine. I mean, I guess we can deal with any responses to that from the panelists. Or should we move on? Let's move on. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's take a group of questions. Yeah. So we'll take three questions. Okay, in a row. Dan.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a comment. I appreciated what Jan said. Nice of you to say that about the campaign I did in Ohio for the U.S. Senate in 2010. Who would have thought there were 26,000 people in Ohio who come out and say that they were socialist? It doesn't compare now to Kshama Sawant, but it was important. And I think one of the things about that campaign was that there were people from the ISO who put a lot of time and support into that. Socialist Alternative supported it. DSA Youth, the Young Democratic Socialist in Ohio, supported it. DSA members supported it, and many other people on the left. And I think one of the things that happens is, like, nobody here, in a certain sense, you're saying, well, the Socialist Alternative campaign, but you can't even claim it anymore. We all claim it. You did such a wonderful thing that everyone's congratulating you, and this becomes a victory of the movement. And I think that's a wonderful sense to create, is the sense that these things are not personal possessions, mm-hmm. they're not party possessions. I remember in the 60s, people say, I'm part of the movement. What does that mean? But the anti-war movement, the civil rights movement, the Chicano movement, the women's movement, it was one common shared movement. And that sense has to be turned into what Jan said, which is, how do we create a basis for cooperation on an ongoing basis so we collaborate in lots of things, as well as in such a coming political campaigns? But great panel. Thank you for doing it.
I think when we think about what's going on in New York today, the tale of two cities, the Democratic Party is between a rock and a hard place. De Blasio cannot serve two masters, the working class or Wall Street, in many respects. I think the conversation that we need to have here in New York, if we have to duplicate Seattle and Minneapolis, is to say that we have to sink the roots in the communities where there are struggles taking place. Organically, what will flow out of that is the confrontation between those who want to advance working class people's interests and those who want to advance the agenda of Wall Street. And through that, the question then becomes, should we run an election? Should that become an expression of our anger? I think the key question that's posed to us today is to sink the roots in our communities, in the workplaces, the question of social struggle. We have to get back to that kind of language. And my final point is what Sharma said to the Boeing workers. She called Boeing an economic terrorist. Who? What politician do you know even use that kind of language? She's already committed to live on the average wage of a worker. The 15-hour rally that took place this past Sunday, she's pledged $15,000 to the campaign. We want to build an organization that lives outside of SA, in fact, that has a life of its own, that can organize in the workplace and in the communities and in the schools. That, to me, is the conversation we need to have. As socialists today, we need to get back to the grassroots. We're not doing that work. We're looking to do that work today.
Great. Yeah. What Democrat is going to call the leading industry of economic terrorists? Yeah.
Eleanor Rogers, also from Socialist Alternative. I agree with Elgier about the task, right? The task is to run electoral challenges on a socialist basis in New York in 4 years' time. The task right now is building grassroots campaigns, community-based campaigns, picking areas. Now, I mean, whether that's organically, there's a campaign that appears in a neighborhood and you start working there, and then flowing from that, it leads to electoral, or whether there's an element which people are starting to discuss, we have this electoral task, now let's focus in and find out where to root ourselves tactically. They can both lead in the same direction. It's about how do we root in different areas and so on. I mean, people were asking kind of for concrete examples or what SA is doing, what's our blueprint. When we, in the last elections, we actually stood in three races. We stood in Boston as well. And Boston's not mentioned because it was a different level of campaign and we were aware of that going in. It was very much raising the flag, trying to generate a little bit of name recognition. We didn't actually make it through the runoff into the main election. We discussed way back at the beginning of the process, we discussed possibly running a candidate in New York. For us, that meant possibly running a candidate in Astoria or possibly running a candidate in Brooklyn in the 39th district. To take up one of your points, there were a number of reasons for not picking either of those or running with it, partly resources, but in 39, one of the key reasons was that the incumbent Democrat was seen as very left-wing, Brad Lander. Now, in 4 years' time, he would be term-limited out. And just to take that district as an example, you have a district there that encompasses Park Slope. You have the Park Slope Green Party, who have built for many years on Huron, you know, reasonably high-profile third-party candidacies for council. Gloria Matera, I don't remember her stats for council elections, but challenging Marty Markowitz some time ago, she got 10% borough-wide, which is not to be sniffed at. One of the weakest areas for the Greens in that constituency was Kensington, getting into geography, but there was a particular area of the constituency they never broke into, and that is where we have been building for the last 3 or 4 years. Actually, we started building by getting people out in that neighbourhood to vote, to campaign for Howie Hawkins in the gubernatorial election. But since then, we helped found Occupy Kensington. We've led a high-profile local campaign on a minimum wage violation in a local store. And we've been building there systematically for 3 or 4 years. Now, whether that's going to lead us in 4 years down the line, that being the constituency that we pick, we don't know. But we know that we have a base there. We have a connection with real people in the community. It was a local campaign that got us in. And we're working with it, and we're committed to it, whether it leads us to an electoral candidacy in that constituency or not. I mean, a couple of broad questions I have for anybody about building towards running candidates in 4 years' time in city elections are, one, is it worth considering for name recognition running for some state level posts that we don't expect to win in the midterms in between? You know, I mean, our state legislature is famously full of useless and corrupt individuals. There's got to be lots of promising people to run against. The other is, when it comes to 4 years' time, this is totally hypothetical, like at this point, how can we tell, but what is the best thing? Is it to pick three constituencies where we have different groups with particularly strong bases and focus on them, or is it to say we want to run 20 candidates across the city, and then within that, focus on the two or three that we think are the most promising? And those are things we have to consider.
My name is Seth Rosenberg. I'm a transit worker, subway driver, and a supporter for the League for the Revolutionary Party. I had a couple of points I wanted to bring up. First, I wanted to thank Alan for bringing up the point about the union leadership. I'm in constant fights with my union leadership. I was at a meeting last night that trying to get us to, just our division, to put a vote against concessions that our union leaders were offering to the MTA, and we got squashed pretty hard. So I feel strongly that what he's saying is true there. And I wanted to take it further with respect to the fact that I think that it's true that they're really squelching industrial action, but at the same time, political campaigns have to recognize that the leaders, the union leaders, are very tied to the Democrats, and that it's not going to be just enough to sideswipe them, it's going to go around them. You have to take on the union bureaucracy and challenge them and point out that in a lot of places workers are fighting on two fronts, against their employers and against their own union leaders. It's so bad in this country. Wisconsin is a classic example of a struggle completely smashed by the Democrats and the union bureaucrats, that, you know, we see struggle after struggle destroyed the, you know, it was described what happened with Boeing, to the point where something that I would consider a defeat, what happened with the Chicago teachers, it was less of a defeat than it was originally could have been, you know, and it was a valiant struggle, but nonetheless, that massive testing and accountability, all that educational reform put in, not as much as the bosses wanted, but nonetheless there. So, but that's a defeat. Nonetheless, it's considered a victory at the level of struggle that we're at now, and I think that's wrong. We have to recognize how much of a obstacle these union leaders are, and that they're going to have to be taken on. And campaigns that decide that they're going to soft pedal that and try and accommodate these union leaders, as opposed to challenging them and getting the ranks to have be more conscious and to get into the fighting mood where we're going to be take industrial action again. That type of campaign is the campaign I don't want to see. I want to see one where these union leaders are taken on, and that, because if we were doing what we want to do, which is to actually raise the consciousness of workers to get back to the place where we have a mass movement here, that's we have mass strikes, general strikes, and that sort of thing, then we're going to have to do that. And it's going to be, you know, it's going to get ugly at points, because the union leadership has a stranglehold on the unions, the Democrats have a stranglehold on the union leaders, and it's not a, you know, it's a type of thing that has to be taken into account. I'd like to hear more about that.
Great.
One more point I wanted to make just quickly is, I also feel like there's an issue of here putting the cart before the horse a little bit with respect to, I mean, what happened in Seattle was a significant victory. And it's, you know, it's the type of thing that can spark a lot of response. It's connected to a working class movement, and I think that's great. At the same time, I think we have to shape our campaigns and our political action to agree on what we want to accomplish in the end. And one thing I haven't heard discussed here at all is something that's important to me, which I consider myself a revolutionary, right? And there's, I think if our end goal is to get rid of capitalism, there has to be some discussion of how we're gonna get there, right? Does the system have to be overthrown? Can it be done through reforms or through parliamentary action? And I think history shows very strongly, in my opinion, take Chile and Allende or Spain in the 30s, that parliamentary action is not the way to go, that we're going to need to form a revolutionary party. So to respond to Alan, he said that, you know, he's talking about the goal of forming a mass party. I think we need to talk about what's necessary to form a mass revolutionary party, not just a more nebulous working class party. I'd like to hear discussion on that.
Great, too. Well, so I think we'll take one more question, and then we're going to have responses from the panelists, and we're out of here, okay? I got to choose somebody randomly, okay? I don't know. This guy's got his hand up the longest. Oh, are you? Let's see. A non-member of Socialist Alternative. Are you not a member? You're okay?
Yeah, I'm a member.
You're not a member?
Good.
For those that don't know me, my name is Frank Llewellyn, and for 10 years I was the National Director of Democratic Socialist America. Okay. I found myself in agreement with most of the things that most of the speakers said. And I don't want to really focus on any particular disagreement. But I do think that what's often lacking in our discussions is somewhat of a broader picture. I think if you look at what's happening in 25 or 30 of the states, you know, the left is not winning, the right is winning. And winning in very serious ways, if you look at women's rights, union rights, voting rights, and that's really a very serious problem that has to be part of our discussion of action and elective action. The second thing I think needs to be a part of this, I think that people alluded to it, but maybe didn't make it as explicit as could be. There is, I think, a large, broad, particularly among younger people, anti-capitalist view. That doesn't mean that it's been turned into a social view. And it's the task of people who call themselves socialists to challenge that and to prove that socialists have ideas that will work and that people will support. And in that sense, the campaigns that you referenced are very good and very important. But the job that those people who won do in office will also be important in relating to those people. And in the general strategic things that have been mentioned, I just want to mention three things. Most non-major party people who are elected to local office are elected in nonpartisan elections. And going from that level to the federal level, where most people who are elected are either Republicans or Democrats, it's very difficult. And the left has not succeeded in that very often. In terms of New York, I think there's lots of opportunities to try to take advantage of what's happened to de Blasio's victory. If you're going to do it electorally and you want to have an independent victory, the only independents who've ever been elected have been elected after they lost the Democratic primary and then were elected on one of those minor party lines, as Tish James was when she was elected to city council. And I think you have to think about that. One of the good things about New York City is it doesn't cost a lot of money to run for city council because you have public finance.
Reverse alphabetical order for responses?
Right, sure. I was gonna mention that campaign finance point because I think the campaign finance laws in New York gives us a lot of flexibility. Moreover, because if we're organizing around an electoral campaign, but we're organizing as open socialists, we're essentially getting some free money from the state to organize as socialists. And I think that makes the electoral option, especially if we could find a way, like they did in Minneapolis, of now counterposing movement work with electoral work, I think that makes this a little bit more interesting or feasible in the short term. I think we have some very good finance laws, some of which I think we have some working families party to thank for some of that, maybe. But the I think the silos point, I think you mentioned the silos analogy, I very much liked. And I think that's very true, because essentially with a campaign like that, like we've just heard about the good work that, let's say, I knew Social Alternative had some major influence in setting up Occupy Kensington. I've heard good things about their activity there. But, you know, I live off the G, I'm not too far from Kensington, but I'm, you know, not that engaged with what, you know, the comrades of Social Alternative are doing there. So in other words, that's partially or mostly my own fault as an individual. Because I think, in other words, what we need to do is we need to build socialist tendencies not bound to organizational barriers. So I see no reason why, in the medium term, maybe I'm an outlier, I probably can't be a part of anything for the short term, which is fine, I'm pretty antisocial, it's okay. But there's no reason why the tendencies that have fine roots and inspiration in Ted Grant can't coexist with the tendencies that find roots and inspiration in Tony Cliff. I think that fundamentally, if you're serious about any sort of like joint political action or regroupment, then you find a way to exist just like the successful revolutionary groups in the past within an open democratic party or organization. I think organization is the correct, you know, word for what we are, for the stage of struggle that we're at, that exists with open, permanent factions, perhaps, you know, not just a pre-conference period or anything of the sort. And I think that is actually an important political goal for the short term. I also wanted to use that cart before the horse analogy too, because I think, in other words, some of the activity the Socialist Alternative did seem, before we saw their success, it might seem to the outsiders as cart before the horse, but obviously there was a great deal of organization done in the background that many of us weren't aware of. But more importantly, I think it actually shows us the importance of, and this word is almost entirely used pejoratively on the left, but voluntarism. It actually shows the importance of actually being willing to go out there and take a risk and put everything on the line. And if these campaigns had been hyped up and failed miserably, you know, there would have been not only an organizational setback, but everyone would have been, you know, all of us that are now saying this is our struggle, we would have also been saying, we told you so. You know, there's many reasons. So, and to your last point, I think that this revolutionary reformist, you know, divide, I think will be very important in 2036. But in the short term, I'm actually not even being facetious in a way. In the short term, I think that if you are a revolutionary and you build a vital, important political presence in the emerging movement, then it'll be the right wing that splits. It'll be the right wing that's alienated in the minority and that splits when the struggle comes to that point. So I think there's no need in the short term to subscribe to any sort of like litmus test participations. And I also, like, one of the brief things that I did disagree with one of Social Alternative's points was this idea that if you build the right program, you know, the working class will come to you. I mean, I think that's an old mythology the left should you know, get rid of and discard. But besides for that, you know, I'm generally on board. I have lots of time, not many resources, lots of time. So, you know, let's do something.
Bhaskar has regrouped the entire international left. I think our work here is done. I guess I just wanted to say a couple things in conclusion. One is the question of the union leaders. I get very wary these days when people use an expression like the union leaders, because I just think that collapses so many different things together that cannot be collapsed together. So I don't believe that Mike Mulgrew, the president of the United Federation of Teachers, can be put in the same category as Karen Lewis, the president of the Chicago Teachers Union. You know, there's been a whole progressive break inside the nurses' unions nationally, starting with the National Nurses United. Now the 37,000 strong nurses' union in New York State has been taken over by a progressive caucus, by a rank-and-file caucus. It's the leadership of that union. And then now there's the reformers in Seattle who look very poised to potentially take control of the Seattle teachers unions. And that is not to say that there aren't real contradictions, pressures, and questions that then exist, not because of any lack of commitment on people's parts or anything like that, but actually because of the material pressures that exist, not just on the union leadership, but on the union membership, as people begin to sort through and work through these questions. And so I think the point that Sandy made at the beginning about that being an uneven process that we want to be a part of, I think the big question for us as a left is not how do we formulate all the right answers and then tell them to people. The question for us as a left is where do we find the spaces where people are trying to find a political and ideological alternative to the one-sided assault that's been happening on working class living standards in this country, and how do we become part of those struggles? How do we talk to those people? How do we engage in a process of radicalization that I don't believe just started this last year or even with Occupy, but has its roots well before Occupy, but has seen a number of different expressions in the continuity of revolutionary organizations, progressive organizations, socialists within that, who are able to relate to every manifestation, I think is a critical sort of question for us to take up. And so I think that we need to separate out those things a little bit. The space that exists for an electoral challenge can take different expressions. I think the fact that socialists can win office as socialists or can run campaigns as socialists from an ideological perspective is incredibly important in this country where we're trying to resuscitate the idea of socialism. I think then the question of how do some of the main organizations of the working class begin to break from the Democratic Party and what it's going to take to do that is a related but also somewhat separate question. I think we need to be able to have discussions about all of these things. I very much agree with the comrade from Socialist Alternative who talked about the need to build campaigns and roots in New York City. I think that in terms of your question about critical support, I think that we immediately have to have a position that we are building a left opposition to de Blasio's administration. I mean, if nothing else, because right now all the pressure on de Blasio is coming from the right. I mean, you listen to the media talk, and you would think that Sawant won mayor of New York City, not Bill de Blasio. I mean, it's literally insane. And they are preparing for a whole right-wing backlash in the same way they prepared a right-wing backlash against David Dinkins when he became mayor of New York City. And we need to begin to build a left. And just to point to some of the campaigns I think we can talk about, there's a group of rank-and-file activists inside the municipal unions who've started a petition campaign to demand full retro and contracts for the New York City workers, which seems to be the one first thing to build de Blasio wants to completely not deliver on or come into opposition with the city unions. You can find it at tinyurl.com/full retro. I think the issues of policing in New York City are absolutely huge. I mean, there's one of the things that I think laid the basis for Bill de Blasio's election was the stop and frisk campaign and all the struggles that exist around police brutality. The fact that Bill Braddon has been appointed as police commissioner and says his plan is not to end stop and frisk, but to mend it, essentially, to reform it in some kind of way. I think we need to talk about how do we build an anti-policing, anti-police brutality movement that can really put pressure on them. There's groups like the Campaign to the New Jim Crow. There's groups groups like the Coalition Against William Braddon. There's people organizing to get ICE, the immigration enforcement, out of Rikers. I don't know if people know, but right now there's a total policy of cooperation between the New York City police and the administration and immigration enforcement, which means that up to 50% of immigrants who are detained in criminal proceedings end up deported before their trials, are deported out of New York City, away from loved ones and families. That's a campaign. There's a number of campaigns that we could begin to get behind. I think the question that then emerges that I think this meeting was meant to address is, how do we increase and strengthen a broader left to be part of that and to amplify those beyond just the individual places where that's taking place? And I don't think the answer is what Bhaskar was saying about just put us all into one big group and pretend we don't have any differences. I mean, that's just not going to go anywhere.
We're just talking about the two groups.
All right. I don't think that's the answer. I think that, you know, people are committed to their politics, and there's a reason people are in separate organizations, and I hope that someday in the future there will be less of the separate organization and more unity amongst us. I think the immediate next step we can take is to engage in practical activity together, which means more discussions like this. It means, you know, the ISO has a bunch of members in Kensington, Brooklyn. Some of them are here.
Them are on my email list.
Great. We should get together and we should talk about how we can cooperate and what that would look like and what that would mean. We should look at the campaigns that are taking place in different places and figure out what, you know, how do we begin to start small, but to begin to build an alternative. And then I think it's not just about the sinking in and the roots, but it's about, even short of an electoral challenge, how do you amplify an ideological alternative to the system? I think Jacobin being on this panel is really important because I think they've played a critical role in taking that place. Perhaps we can talk about forums on key issues that can begin to build to a broader audience and reach to a broader audience. We can begin to talk about staking out some positions on some of the key questions that are confronting people in this country and begin to create a renewal of a political culture and a political left in this city, because I think you can begin to see the basis for that, and not to retreat back just into where we can sink roots in our various places, but begin to amplify a different kind of left and a different kind of strength. And I'll just end quickly, because Ben said I could announce this on that front. I'm part of a journal called the International Socialist Review, which just has launched itself as a quarterly in a new format as a space for debate on the left. There's a report from Syriza in the current issue and like what's going on with the Greek left, and we're having a launch party on Friday, January 31st. So there'll be people with flyers, and come check it out if you want to come. It's open to everyone. I bet.
Before I reintroduce Alan, six words. Karen Lewis for mayor of Chicago.
There was a lot of points made, and I have to say I agree with a lot of the points with regard to the necessity of building a movement. When we start discussing about New York, I think that the idea, the critical issue at the moment, is to build a movement that will begin to campaign for a living wage, for union rights, for working people in this city to be able to reclaim the city that's become a playground for the for big business and Wall Street. And I think that the critical issue for the left is for all of us to be involved. Like for us in Socialist Alternative, we've been involved with the Occupy movement, Kensington and Astoria in Long Island City. We've been involved in building the anti-fascist movement regarding the Greek left. We've been involved with union struggles and a series of unions over the past period. And I think we need to continue to do that. But I think the critical, I think the issue of the $15 an hour minimum wage, which has begun to develop some real legs over the past period, in the sense of this movement, raises a whole series of issues regarding the fact that people cannot live with the money that they make, and I think it has the potential for us to build around May Day, for example, to build a strong socialist contingent around 15, fighting for 15 as a minimum wage. The idea of building campaigns on the ground, real campaigns, sinking roots. One of the lessons from both in Minneapolis and Seattle is that we don't want to run just abstract campaigns. You want to run campaigns on the basis of having actually developed real roots on the ground. And I think that's something with regard to the issue of the program. Actually, our program in many ways is not something we have to start from a kind of view of we have a program where workers will come. Actually, we see the program as a dialogue. We see the idea of slogans and what, how you pose the program. We see that as something that you test and you have to try. There's peculiarities in the consciousness that I think are very important. For example, today, unlike the 1930s or even the late 1800s, there is no mass conscious socialist even minority. There is no that consciousness of socialism as an alternative to capitalism. That's not the case at the moment. You have a majority. However, you have a majority of people in the urban centers who want living wage jobs. They want to tax the rich. They want repulsed by the corporate dictatorship that exists at the present time. And they want to put an alternative of people over profits. They put it in those terms. They don't put it in classical Marxist terms the way, and so on. That is that consciousness that exists. And this was what was shown, and of course the Occupy movement with, reintroduced the ideas of capitalism, of system change, of the 99%, basic class ideas have been reintroduced, and so on. Now, this anti-corporate, if you like, mood is the raw material from which a new movement of the class consciousness and a revival of socialist consciousness over the next week, on the basis of struggle, as people begin to mobilize, to become part of a movement, that is what is going to generate regenerate the idea of class consciousness. And I think that in many ways, the movement for a living wage and so on, if you think back over how the First International, Second International were built at the time as progressive movements and so on, it was not built on the basis, agree with socialism as a kind of utopian schema, the reason why working people flocked into the socialist parties was primarily because they saw the socialists and other currents fighting for the 8-hour day, fighting for trade union rights, fighting for democratic rights, the right of the working people to vote. In many ways, it was one of the main reasons why the socialist movement was able to lead to the rise of mass parties of the working class at that stage. So I think that is some of the lessons that we have learned over the past period. I think there will be opportunities, as other comrades, brothers, sisters made the point, is that there will be opportunities for electoral campaigns. I think that we need to look at concretely as these opportunities arise on the basis of struggle, we're going to need to review. I think there is going to be a need for the left to collaborate and to begin to develop this dialogue and discussion in terms of how we can go forward. I think that the idea of the need for an alternative to capitalism is an absolutely critical idea. This is a truly revolutionary idea of how we're going to be able to end the system that produces poverty, unemployment, environmental degradation, and so on and so forth. I forgot to mention that actually the issue of our campaign in Boston, for example, was linked to a very large degree with a major success that we had with the National Nurses Union. Our comrade who ran, James Whelan, who ran in Boston, actually passed a resolution at the National Nurses Convention last year that called for a break with the Democrats and Republicans. The union endorsed actually that campaign as in the executive, and of course we're trying to field test it on the basis of trying to develop a progressive support among progressive unions in the case of Boston in the past period. But that is something again that we're going to have to test and try and develop. I think that some of the developments. We're going to need more discussion about some of the developments that are taking place. I think in the case of Chicago and with CORE, I think it's critical for the socialist left to campaign for the union openly, to break with pressure politics and so on. And we have to be more open, in my opinion, about the need to speak more openly and critique. We have to support union officials and union leaders when they take a step forward. We have to say that's a step forward. But when they take a step back and so on, we also have to say, in a friendly way, we have to say that this is not leading anywhere and so on and so forth. Because otherwise, we're not going to be able to educate the most advanced sections of workers and youth. And I think that's one of the lessons that comes out of the struggle and the successes that we had over the past period. The campaigns of Socialist Alternative were pioneering campaigns They were in the spirit along the lines of what Dan Labotz and other socialists have done over the past period in terms of opening their road for the movement. We do not see these campaigns as anything that is in any, it's just for Socialist Alternative. In the case of Seattle, we're initiating a major campaign for the fight for 15. The bosses are going to toss, if the SeaTac campaign, they spent millions of dollars to try to defeat the campaign in SeaTac for the 15. In the case of Seattle, if it comes to a referendum, they're going to spend tens of millions of dollars to try to defeat working people having even the beginnings of a living wage and so on. We're going to need to mount a serious fight back in order to make this into a fight. And if you think about that, that is the kind of politics, from the point of view of the mobilization of the working class, that can also reintroduce the key lessons of the struggle, the need for struggle, for solidarity, and the ideas of socialism. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks for coming, everybody.